Hear ye, hear ye. Haunted house on the hill heaves hefty horrors half drenched in hemoglobin.
Oh my god.
This
I wanna die
is fine. Whoa. Oh. Somebody say die. I'm manifesting your death as I'm strangling.
Oh, how am I doing this?
This is finally the story of the guy I kept alluding to tonight. And his house, which might be the source of more ghost stories and urban legends than anywhere else in this part of town. Frank Vanderlip Sr. He was born November 13th, 1864 on a farm near Aurora, Illinois, like a common rube that he was.
Ha,
edgy.
Rube.
When he grew up, he started writing for local newspapers while also going to school for economics. He made a name for himself as a writer because he would focus on business stories. So to get an insider's perspective, he bought stock in every company in town so that he could attend the shareholder meetings and get scoops that the other reporters couldn't.
Wow, okay.
So that was his tactic. Eventually, he worked his way into the big leagues of the Chicago newspapers, where he developed a reputation amongst the financiers as someone to be afraid of because of his editorial takedowns of several of the big financial institutions. One business guy saw Vanderlip's family crest, which had three wolves on it, and he pointed to one that had particularly sharp fangs and said, "This one's Vanderlip." Little did he know.
Full moon.
Boom, come out.
You're going to find
call
out.
Call me that on the full moon. Yeah. I'll show you just how sharp my lips are. He was just a brash, young, hotshot financial reporter, and that caught the attention of a banker in Chicago who was made the U.S. Secretary of Treasury under President McKinley in 1897 and decided to take Vanderlip along to D.C. with him as his assistant. This is where Vanderlip pivoted from just a financial reporter to a financial doer. So while working for the Treasury, he helped lay the framework for a new central banking institution that would be created years later and would be known as the Federal Reserve.
Oh.
So he was one of the planners of that. He managed to also help make a deal that sold $1.4 billion in Spanish-American war bonds, which was credentials enough to land him the job of president of the National Citibank in New York in 1909, which is now known as Citibank.
Oh, wow.
So he was the president of that. He turned them into the biggest bank in the country by the time he left the company in 1919. Meanwhile, Vanderlip had become something of a kiss my lip as he fell in love and married a woman named Gussie Mabel Cox on May 19th, 1903.
Name I've ever heard.
Yeah, on three counts. She just went by Narcissa, which is an even older name.
Yeah.
Narcissa was a very progressive woman. She was active in many women's rights organizations and was instrumental in ending child labor in the country. She got pensions for the elderly. She helped get federal aid for education. She helped get full citizenship rights for women.
Oh, cool. Okay.
So she and her husband also established the first Montessori school in the country for their children to go to, of which they had many of them. They were the aptly named Narcissa and Frank Arthur Jr. Then there was Virginia Jocelyn. Get ready for some old names.
Oh, yeah.
Kelvin Cox, John Mann, and Charlotte Delight.
Oh, these are cowboys, you're saying?
Yeah, this is Western. Their merry band of cowboys.
These are folktale legends.
But in 1913, Vanderlip got up to another scheme, and he and a group of investors that included J.P. Morgan bought up the 16,000 acres that is now known as Palos Verdes for about $2 million with plans to develop it as a new community and combine all the cities in the peninsula into one.
And they invented real estate. Yeah.
This is why he's referred to as the father of Palos Verdes.
Okay.
However, Vanderlip had never been to the West Coast, but when he finally came out to see this property that he'd just spent a small fortune on, sight unseen, he was in love. He loved it. He called Palos Verdes a dreamland, sea and sky. His son Kelvin would describe it as the jeweled earlobe of Los Angeles. The area reminded Vanderlip of southern Italy, so he decided to build his family a summer home there at what is now 99 Vanderlip Drive on the top of the hill in 1916.
You're still there?
Yeah, it's still there.
Okay. Still there like a ghost, or is it like actually still there?
It's still there. Literally.
There's tours of it.
You can visit it on weekdays. It was originally called the Old Ranch Cottage, but it now goes by simply the Cottage.
Okay.
It gets newer. You might recognize the name Vanderlip because that's the name of the dam that fails in the movie Chinatown.
That's what it is.
Yep.
Thank you.
Robert Towne, who was from San Pedro, he named it that because they actually filmed part of the movie at this mansion, and one of the Vanderlips that was living there at the time kept bothering Roman Polanski, so Towne decided to name the dam that causes a tragedy after him.
Funny.
They also wanted to have guests while they were there, so they built a little villa in 1924 called Villetta, but is more commonly known as Villa Narcissa. They also built a barn and stables and the farmstead, which is now the Portuguese Bend Riding Club, and Narcissa donated 3.5 of their acres where eventually the Wayfarers Church was going to be built. Peacocks are a big thing here in Palos Verdes, and there's a couple stories of how they got here. One being that they were given to Vanderlip as a gift from William Wrigley Jr. from his aviary on Catalina Island, but the timeline doesn't add up there really, so the most likely story is that they were actually a gift from Lucky Baldwin's daughter.
Oh, wow, okay.
So anyway, Vanderlip had this beautiful property overrun with peacocks with a perfect family and plans to develop the rest of the land and sell it off. and then World War One hit. Then things started to bounce back after the war, and the plans were once again coming together, and then the Depression hit. And this apparently was when relations within the family went sour. Here we go.
The Depression broke up families? Why?
There are a few incidents that are said to have happened here. The first was that one of their daughters had fallen in love with an African-American man, and this was not something that Vanderlip liked.
He invented Banks. He probably wouldn't like that.
Yeah, he invented Banks. Yeah. He forbade her from seeing this man, but it was too late for that because she was already pregnant with his child. Mm-hmm. So what Vanderlip did was he built an asylum slash prison across the street from their house. And once the baby was born, he locked his daughter away in it and made her watch as he killed not only her black lover, but also their baby.
That's real.
With nothing left to live for, the daughter then killed herself in the prison.
This is
Stick
real.
Stick with me. That wasn't all. They also say that some young girl was on the property there at some point. Maybe she was a witness, and she too was killed and thrown down the well. But there's more. It wasn't just Vanderlip who went insane here. Narcissa also began to lose her mind. Some people say she was possessed or that she just had a mental illness, but one day she took an axe and chopped up the rest of their family and their two dogs and buried them in the walls. And then when people on the outside were finally able to get into the house, they found her hanging from a beam in the living room. So the spiritual residue...
I have a picture of that.
That's the same pose.
That's real.
We'll get to it. The spiritual residue of this has been reported by locals for decades, and everyone has heard or experienced their own story about this area. On one of our first dates, we were in Palos Verdes, and Melissa. Yep. Not our first date.
You never take me out. You never call them dates, for sure.
You never tell me. Oh, you never take me south.
We're just hanging out.
I don't know what we are yet. So Melissa told me, we were driving through there, and Melissa told me this weird story about ghost dogs chasing people that don't bark because they had their voice boxes removed so you wouldn't hear them coming until they got you. So I pulled over and told her to get out because no maid of mine will ever speak such nonsense.
I'm going to see a feral cat lady.
I've got a date with a fetus. Yeah. But it turns out that's a common story there because that story always stuck with me. And then when I was reading this, like, everyone has that story. A lot of stories involve glowing ghost dogs that roam the grounds. One person says when they got near the mansion, they saw these ghosts. And when they tried to bark, they had light coming out of their mouths. Others have said these dogs have actually rammed into their cars as they were driving by. There's another story of something that rams your car as you drive by around the pretty treacherous Portuguese Bend Road. But this is a white ghost van that tries to run people off the road. One lady who lived in a nearby house said her earrings went missing, and the next day she was walking home when she felt that there was something walking behind her. So she looked around and there was nothing there except her missing earrings on the ground. Some say that there's an entrance to an underground tunnel at the Wayfarer's Chapel that leads to the mansion, which is used by Satanists to drag in victims for sacrifices.
Okay.
It's hard to get to the house itself because it's now part of a gated community, but people have seen figures in the windows and heard crying kids coming from inside the house. Others see a woman dressed in gray who screams at people who come out to look. She says, "You're not supposed to be here," to them. They believe this is Vanderlip's daughter. One person said they went there and heard gunshots and then a woman screaming and then flames coming out the windows because the house was badly burned by a fire in 1962. And then a woman stepped out onto the balcony and he asked if everything was okay. And she said, "Why don't you come in and find out?"
No.
"Why don't you come up and see me sometime?" At which point he scurried away, as was his job. These are all horrific stories. Yeah. They're stemming from a few extremely horrific incidents, but here's the scariest part of all of this. Ask me if it ever happened.
Did it ever happen?
No.
Gosh darn it. None
of this ever happened.
I wanted that tragedy to be real so bad.
I know. Like, one of the first things I read was like all these scary things, and the next thing was like, this never happened. These are all urban legends. None of this happened. People may have seen these things, but all the stuff about Vanderlip and Narcissa killing their family, that never, ever, ever happened. Vanderlip died June 30th, 1937 of natural causes because he was disappointed in his daughter. And Narcissa died March 5th, 1966 in Scarborough, New York, also of natural causes. She hung herself.
Yeah.
Her obituary...
Gravity is a natural cause.
Gravity's a force of nature. Yeah. Her obituary mentioned how she had helped found the League of Women Voters and also influenced Eleanor Roosevelt personally to become more feminist. There was nothing in there about her or her husband killing their children or themselves before they actually died.
Liberal media won't want you to know about it. And the daughter?
She's fine. If any of
she's still right here.
Hey! I didn't do it. I am not a ghost. So if any of that did happen, it's even more impressive that they were able to cover it all up and still pretend to be living after they had already killed themselves. Yeah. So the mansion was passed on to their son Kelvin and his wife Ellen, who they were an interesting couple. She came with her family from Norway to Illinois, where she developed a habit of getting in good with rich and famous families and came close to marriage with one of the heirs of the John Deere company. She was then convinced to move to LA by Sterling Hayden, who is the guy who played the cop that gets shot by Al Pacino in The Godfather.
He is, but he's also the main actor of The Killing and Crime Wave and a lot of really great movies.
Yeah, but Al Pacino finished him. Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, that's it. That's way cooler.
She came to LA. She became a secretary at Warner Brothers, where she was introduced to Kelvin and fell into a romance with him that was written about in the tabloids by Hedda Hopper. They had a lot of celebrity riddle parties in that house on the hill. Myrna Loy lived in the guest house before World War II. Before World War II came and they turned her into bullets. Paulette Goddard.
Oh, yeah, Paulette Goddard.
God, Catholic. And Burgess Meredith, they honeymooned there in 1944. They were married.
That old librarian?
That old banker turned librarian due to apocalypse? Dr. Seuss stayed there for a while in 1946. He was friends with them. Ted Geisel.
Ted Geisel stayed there?
You may know him as...
The real Grinch?
Human Grinch Ted Geisel. Kelvin died of lung cancer in 1956, and Ellen moved herself and the kids to Europe, where she was given the Legion of Honor for helping restore art in France. But after 8 years, she moved back to the mansion and was instrumental in getting the Wayfarers Chapel built, and also Marineland. She helped get that built. She was aware of the legends and the ghost stories about her family, many of which were attributed to her, even though she wasn't even in the picture when they supposedly happened. She referred to herself as the Wicked Witch in the Haunted Castle. She said, "I have been the target of every brave high schooler who wanted to break my gate and climb my fences." She even admitted that some of these stories of a ghost lady on the grounds telling people to leave was just her trying to scare people away.
It really happened!
She died not that long ago, July 2009. She was 90 years old. The house is still owned by her children, but I think maybe the guest house was sold outside the family in 2012 or vice versa.
You gotta take Myrna Loy with it.
Yeah, she's not going anywhere. A guy named Don Christie, who lives there, he's a step-grandson of Vanderlip, says he's lived there his whole life, never experienced anything like what's mentioned in these ghost stories.
And what's he say about the asylum across the street?
He says, don't look at that.
Pretend that's not real. Don't look in the well.
Don't mind that, yeah. He says there is really nothing up here to see, and I would so appreciate it if the public would leave the Vanderlip family alone, which sounds like a cover-up.
The words of a person covering something up.
He also admits to purposely scaring people who come by at night also. Now, why, knowing the facts, do these stories about this still exist? They seem to have started in the 60s, and the family believes it's because in the 50s, Ellen's dad would come visit from Norway, and he was this old-fashioned Norwegian guy. He would walk around the property at night in like a long like Dickens sleep shirt and a sleeping cap holding a lantern.
And his friend Marlo would be right behind him.
He was always rattling chains.
Oh, a Norwegian old-time remedy for getting rid of the cold.
It's the only way to fall asleep if you have insomnia in Norway. People probably saw that and just went from there. Yeah. So also, the Vanderlip family was pretty private, and not that much about them was really known to the public, so they just got Boo Radley'd by everyone else in the neighborhood. But why do we still get scared of these stories? We're told to our faces that they never happened, literally by the people who were brutally murdered.
Yeah.
Do we just want the world to be a scarier place than it already is? Or do we just want to kind of, yeah, that's right, scary to be afraid of, while knowing in the back of our minds that it's not actually real? Whatever it is, I'm Aaron Mankey!